Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Aidan Sharkey. I'm an attending anesthesiologist at the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston, Massachusetts. And today is our second lecture on basic cardiac point of care ultrasound. The key takeaways of this talk will be to discuss the parasternal long and the parasternal short axis views that are used for cardiac point of care ultrasound. We will discuss image acquisition along with normal sonoanatomy and how we may utilize these views for patient care. The parasternal long axis is often the first view we obtain in cardiac point of care ultrasound. To obtain this view, we place the probe at the left sternal border in the third to fourth intercostal space. The probe indicator is orientated towards the patient's right shoulder, as indicated by the blue arrow in the diagram. Our standard view in this window should appear as depicted in this video loop and cartoon representation, where we can visualize the right and left ventricle, the mitral and aortic valves, along with the left atrium and a portion of the ascending aorta. At the lower portion of the screen, we should also be able to visualize the descending aorta as seen in our images. Left ventricular assessment can be assessed in this view both qualitatively and quantitatively. Qualitatively, left ventricular function can be eyeballed, where good left ventricular contractility can be seen visually, thus suggesting good function as displayed on the video loop on the left. Or poor contractility can be appreciated, indicating poor left ventricular function as displayed in the video loop on the right. Quantitatively, we can also easily assess left ventricular function in this view using a simple method known as E-point septal separation. This measurement is obtained by placing the M-mode tracer over the distal tip of the anterior mitral valve leaflet, as in the clip on the left of this screen. The mitral valve waveform on M-mode contains two peaks in patients in sinus rhythm, the E-point and the A-point. In patients with good left ventricular function, the E-point, which corresponds to maximal mitral valve opening, should hit or come very close to the interventricular septum. The distance between the E-point and the interventricular septum is called the E-point septal separation, and this is negatively correlated with left ventricular function, with a distance of less than 7 millimeters correlating to normal ejection fraction, and a distance greater than 10 millimeters corresponding with decreased cardiac function. The parasternal long axis view is also useful for visually assessing the aortic valve leaflets for sclerosis. Normally, the aortic valve leaflets should appear as thin, pliable leaflets that are freely mobile, as in the video clip on the left. Contrast this to a patient with aortic stenosis, where the leaflets are thick, heavily calcified, and non-mobile, as seen in the video loop on the right. Parasternal long axis view can also be useful for the assessment of pericardial effusions. A pericardial effusion appears as free fluid between the heart and pericardium, as depicted by the red arrows in this video loop, and can be distinguished from a pleural effusion by its position above the descending aorta. A pleural effusion, which is also seen in this video loop, as demonstrated by the yellow arrows, will be located below the descending aorta. Our next view that we are going to discuss is the parasternal short axis view. In order to obtain this view, we rotate the probe from the parasternal long axis view so as the indicator is now facing towards the patient's left shoulder. We are still left of the sternum and in the third or fourth intercostal space, like we were for the parasternal long axis view. Our standard view in this window should appear as depicted in this video loop and cartoon representation, where we can visualize the round or donut-shaped left ventricle, along with the crescent-shaped right ventricle that is wrapping around the left ventricle. This view is useful for qualitatively assessing left ventricular function by eyeballing contractility. In these images, we can see good contractility and function on the left, compared to poor contractility and function in the video loop on the right. More advanced analysis could involve analyzing the ventricle to look for wall motion abnormalities and trying to localize the infarct if there is one present. In this view, we can assess territories supplied by the LAD, RCA, and left circumflex coronary arteries. Finally, the parasternal short axis view can be useful in the assessment of right ventricular pressure and volume overload. This is achieved by examining the interventricular septum throughout the cardiac cycle. Flattening of the septum, creating the so-called D-shaped septum, indicates right ventricular pressure overload if it occurs in systole, and volume overload if it occurs in diastole. In the example on this screen, we can see flattening of the interventricular septum in systole, indicating that this patient may have an element of right ventricular pressure overload. That concludes our second lecture on basic cardiac point of care ultrasound today. In summary, we went through the parasternal long and parasternal short axis views. We talked about how to obtain these views, the relevant sonoanatomy, and how we may utilize the images obtained for patient care. Thank you for watching, and I hope you found this topic helpful.